This is a response to your video, Fred, called Magical Believing, and I'm making it kind of straight after watching it because there's quite a few things that I want to raise as a result, and I don't want them to kind of fall out of my head. I'm not quite sure where to start. Firstly, I can relate to what you're saying about, you know, sort of seeing that we take an awful lot on trust, which is, I think, kind of part of what you're saying, not the main thrust, but I'll come to the main thrust in a minute. You know, we say we know this to be true, or we believe this to be true, and I think more often than not, it is that we believe something to be true rather than we know it to be true. You know, even when we say scientists have proved, we have no personal evidence at all. We take them on trust as much as we might take anything else on trust. It depends upon the senses, the particular senses that we emphasise or that we are most engaged with as to what we see, what we perceive, how we interpret that. And I don't just mean the physical senses in terms of how we interact with something, but how we feel about what we see and how well, how much it pertains to other things that we've seen of a similar nature or not. But there are very few things that we can make absolutely categorical statements about, because as you point out in your video, you know, we're not seeing all that's there. We are dependent upon the senses that we have, and they are only ever partial. They don't pick up everything on any spectrum by any stretch of the imagination, and nor do the, any of the scientific measuring equipment that exists. You know, it measures more than our senses can, but there are still other things that it can't measure. Right, so move on to you said you did chaos magic, you'd done chaos magic, and then you cited Robert Anton Wilson. And what you talked about was very interesting, but there are many, many forms of chaos magic. I'll put just a couple of bits in the low bar. It's kind of a highly individualistic way of going about perceiving things of that nature anyway. So what you describe is one method, one means of doing that. One of the things I found particularly interesting about what you said, and I'm not sure how well I'm going to be able to describe this, you know, you talked about the kind of scales falling from your eyes when you immerse yourself in something, and you can suddenly see the reality in it. And then you move on to something else. Now that's, maybe I'm a natural chaos magician, but I do that all the time, but in a different way, because I'm not, I have never been looking for absolutes in things. I'm always looking for, that's just really hard to describe. But I have immersed myself in various different ways of perceiving things, various different setups and models of looking at life, in order to see whether I can find something which I recognise. And I almost invariably can. I mean, there's also almost invariably a load of tack-ons around it that don't, and also no model of that nature, of any nature, encompasses all of reality. And I think that's kind of part of the fascination of doing that kind of thing, is that you're not going into something, or me, sorry, I should say me, I'm not going into something in order to find an absolute truth or a perfect description or explanation for life, the universe and everything. I know that everything is one way of perceiving it, along with the other myriad of ways, and that one can move and shift between these or use these things to use as filters, almost to kind of place that, you know, that philosophy or that belief system or that method or that whatever as a kind of what are those things called? You know, where you place something, a silhouette over something, and then you can see the shapes appear or not behind it. I can't remember what it's called. But you know, these are kind of like something that you place over your perception of reality, and each one has a different pattern, and so you see different things. It reveals different things and it secretes different things. And surely anyone seeking after any kind of truth has got to be able to be mobile within that. You know, if you take one particular template and go bang and put that between you and everything, then there is inevitably going to be a series of things that you can't see through it. Because there is no one template that reveals all of reality, which is why you have to keep doing. You know, why is what you were describing was so, it can be so very valuable in terms of revealing kind of revelations about that's why that looks like that, and that's why they see that like that, and you're, but the jigsaw puzzle that you're trying to put together is infinitely massive. So any theory or any belief system or any idea or concept or philosophy or anything is always only partial and only ever going to be able to provide you with, you know, one piece of this jigsaw or one way of looking at it. I'll see if I can find that video and maybe link that as well. Because it's actually called, the original was about 360. It's being able to see all the way around, which is the name of a video I made recently. But I once wrote an article about, you know, being able to see with clarity, and that, you know, we all have our own position in reality. We all stand in a particular place, and if we can either travel and look at different places in different ways and then share those different ways, or share with one another from the place on which we stand what we perceive, and that doesn't necessarily mean we're going to find any absolute reality either, but it does mean that we will find more of it. We will have an increasing picture, and we'll need less and less belief. You know, but in order to be able to do that, one has to be able to put other things down and pick up something new and look at it, but not cling to it. Never cling to it.